fluids. Now, remember guys, our body is almost 60 to 70%, we have water in the body. Okay, so fluids means water. So 60 to 70% of the whole human body is, say, 60 to 70% we have water. Means you can imagine our cells and tissues are submerged in fluid. Okay, so if you take a glass here, that's a glass, so it's, so 60 to 70% is water in our body. Means what? If a person's weight is 100 kilo, if his weight is 100 kilo, then I can say his 65 kilos is because of water. Rest of the things are only because of his fluids or because of the bones and cells and tissues. Okay, so today we are dealing with water, and then we'll go for RBC, red blood cell count in the blood. Okay, so when you say 62%, now again this 60%, okay, let's make a round figure so that you can understand. Okay, let's make a round figure. 60% of our human body is water. So two-thirds, let's divide it into two-thirds, like 20, 20, 20. So two-thirds of this is intracellular fluid. Okay, two-thirds. So intracellular fluid is two-thirds. Now what is intracellular? Listen, our fluid in the human body is distributed. The fluid in the human body is distributed. So we know we have cells. So these are the cells. And there are blood vessels. These are blood vessels. Okay. So where is the water present? Water is present in the cells. So when water is present in the cells, we call it intracellular because it's inside the cells. Okay, that is intracellular fluid. When this same water is present outside the cells, then we call it extracellular fluid. So extracellular is outside the cells. So outside the cells is, out of that, it is one-third of human body, one-third. So if your weight is 70 kilograms, suppose your weight is 70 kilograms, so two-third is water. So let's say round figure, around 45. So out of 45, two-third is intracellular. Two-third means we divide into three equal half and then take two, let's say 24. So 24 liters are intracellular. 24 liters of fluid is present in inside the cellulars. Rest of the 12 liters are our extracellular. Okay, so rest of the fluid is extracellular, right? So when you say extracellular, means fluid is present outside the cells. So some water is present inside the cell, some water is outside the cell. That is called extracellular. Extracellular means fluid that is present here, and also fluid that is present in the blood vessels. So I'm talking about blood. So this blood plus this fluid makes up the extracellular fluid. Okay, so extracellular fluid means this blood inside the blood vessels, we call it intravascular. Intravascular. So extracellular fluid is intravascular plus this muscle fluid. Okay, plus this fluid around the cells, that is present around the cells, not inside the cells, is called interstitial fluid. Interstitial fluid. Okay, this is first day, so you'll have some difficulty in grabbing the terms, but I'm sure after 1 month you'll be expert in this thing. So don't worry, it happens with everyone. So what we are discussing here, fluid is present inside the cells, called intracellular fluid. Fluid that is present outside the cell is extracellular fluid. Now extracellular fluid is again two compartments. Some amount of fluid is present in the blood vessel, that is your blood, that is around 5 liters. So you have normally 4 to 5 liters of blood depending upon the persons. And some amount of fluid is present inside the this space, that is called interstitial space. Okay, that is called interstitial fluid. Alright, so the whole body fluid compartment is intracellular, extracellular. Now extracellular is intravascular fluid, that is around 5 liter. So out of this 12 liter, 5 liter is in the blood. So 7 liter is interstitial. Now in this interstitial, we have some also drainage pipe, like every home has a drainage pipe that takes the sewage out. We have also this type of drainage pipe here. Drainage pipe. Okay. some sort of drainage pipe, which takes the waste particles and take it to the veins. So this is called lymphatic system. Lymphatic system. So some amount of fluid also is present here in the lymphatic system. And apart from the where other spaces, you can imagine where is the fluid apart from that. So there is blood fluid in as a blood, there is fluid here, there is fluid in the lymphatic system. Apart from that, in extracellular, now we can extend this extracellular compartment. The fluid is also present in the surrounding the spaces of lungs. Some fluid is present in our joints. Some fluid is present in the heart, okay, around the pericardium. So this covering, we'll discuss everything. So there is some pericardial fluid around the heart. Some fluid is present in the pleura, surrounding the lungs. Some fluid is present in the joints, that is called synovial fluid. And some fluid is present in our eyes also. So there are lots of fluid scattered all around the body, and some fluid is present in kidneys also. So there are a lot of fluid present all over the compartment. So everything is extracellular. So intracellular means it's easy. Intracellular, the fluid is inside the cells. The intracellular fluid is 24 liters. Rest of the 12 liters is extracellular, which is divided by many of the compartments. It is shared. Okay, so that is 5 liters, we give it to the blood circulation. Rest of the blood fluid is in the heart, lungs, joints. Some in the most of the fluid is in the interstitial space, and some fluid also in the lymphatic system. So you can imagine in our body, the cells are just submerged. Means in our body, the cells, it has all water. This water is here inside the cells, and water is also outside the cells. Means you can imagine your cells are submerged in water. Okay, like for example, if you take a bowl of soup, it's just like that. So everything is submerged in the soup. So same way our human body is also like a soup. So all the cells and tissues, they are just floating because all surrounded with water. Now imagine hot summer climate, what happens? We sweat a lot, right? And we go for, you often heard a very common term called dehydration. We say, oh, he's dehydrated. What happens here? So we lot blood, we lot means we have blood, and so we sweat, right? So you do any sort of exercise, any sort of thing, or you are sweating because of the hot and humid climate. So where the sweat goes out from? The sweat goes out from the skin, you know that. So means we are losing blood from this skin. So this, we are losing blood from here. This blood from here go to the skin. So these blood vessels, they are semi-permeable membrane, means water can constantly talk to each other. So whatever the water is present in the blood, this water is constantly flowing in and out. Okay, so when we are sweating, it means from 5 liters of blood, it becomes gradually 4 liters. Just for example, okay, I'm just giving a number that if you are sweating a lot, means you are losing water from where? From the intravascular compartment. Means you are losing water from here. So more and more water you are losing, more and more water are coming from here to fill it up. So your 5 liter is constantly maintained. So your blood don't become thick or thin by losing water. Okay, so you are constantly sweating, constantly you are losing water, and if you are losing water from the blood, then constantly water is pulled from here to here, because there it is just this partition means. Okay, you can interrupt me in the middle if you don't understand, huh? So there is blood is, sorry? I don't understand that, what you said. Okay, so this is blood and this is interstitial compartment, interstitial. Okay, and here are the cells. These are the cells. So fluid from here to here is constantly there, is moving from here to here. Okay, it's constantly moving. They can move. So when the blood, the fluid in the blood goes down, fluid from the here is pulled here to maintain the equilibrium. So what I'm saying that if you are dehydration, means in dehydration when you lose lots of water, so you are losing water in the form of sweat. So what will happen? Fluid from here will be pulled more. Now this dehydration is going on. You are sweating and sweating and sweating and not drinking water. Okay. So let's imagine you are not able to find water or you are not drinking water. Okay. So this is your stomach. And this is your water in the stomach. So when you drink, this is water. This water is absorbed to the blood. This water goes inside the blood. It is absorbed. What we call as absorption. So when you are drinking water, water from the stomach is going to the blood. So you are drinking a lot of water, blood will become from 5 liter to 6 liter. But that will create a very high pressure. So immediately the fluid will move from here to here. Now fluid can also move here to the cells. So when you're drinking a lot of water, let's imagine you just take a 2 liters of water and drink. So these 2 liters will move to here from by absorption. So 5 liters will become 7 liters, right? Now blood cannot maintain, these blood vessels cannot maintain 7 liters of blood. It is very high pressure. Imagine a hose pipe, you are putting 7 liters of fluid water through the hose pipe instead of 5 liters. So what will happen? If you open the hose pipe, it will come out in high pressure. And it will be flooded. So there is a chances of tear here. There is a chances of rupture of blood vessels. What we call high pressure. So when a person has a high pressure, these things can rupture. If it with high pressure. So immediately this extra fluid is transported to the interstitial, this is the surrounding space. So now this interstitial space is more flooded. More water is here. So what will happen? This water will go. So when it is from the interstitial space, the water will move here.
Sir?
Yeah.
Sir, I have a question.
Yes, sure.
Sir, regarding the interstitial fluids, mm-hmm. Sir, I am still confused. Mm-hmm. I really don't understand that bit.
Sorry?
Sir, I don't understand the interstitial fluid. What did you mean by that?
Okay, fine. I start it again. Wait. So these are our cells, this is the blood vessels, okay. So fluid is inside the cell, what is called intracellular fluid. So this is intracellular fluid. So here there is the blood, okay. So fluid is here also. So what is blood? Blood is filled with, blood is mixture of water and cells, okay. And so these cells, human cells, they are all in a floating. They are floating in this submerged in the water. They are floating. So all our cells, they are floating in water. So this lake or this sea of water is called interstitial fluid. So interstitial fluid is the fluid that is outside the cells and outside the blood vessels. So this lake of fluid or this river of fluid where our human cells are submerged, are floating, is called interstitial fluid. Is that okay?
Understood.
Yeah, thank you. So,
thank you.
So every time you are sweating, what I'm saying, every time you are sweating, you are losing water from here. So I told you we have 5 liters of blood. So 4 to 5 liters depending upon the person's size. So suppose, for example, you lost 1 liter of fluid, not blood, fluid, this is your sweat, 1 liter of fluid in your sweating. So now this 5 liters will become 4 liters, obviously. So we have to deficit it, we have to fill it this gap because of this deficit. So body will try, then this 1 liter will come from here. So immediately fluid will move from here to here. And it will again become 5 liter. So in this way, our body maintains the water balance. Okay. So now what will happen? 1 liter is deficit here. So most of this water will be pulled from here. So that 1 liter will come from here, from the cells. Suppose you are now sweating and sweating and sweating and you are not replacing. So suppose this 1 liter has gone to 5 liter. That's a very big amount. Okay, you were in the somewhere in the Pacific Ocean and did not get any chance of drinking water. So you are now in severe dehydration state. Means what? Your blood volume has become, now you have lost 4 liters. So means 5 liters, you have lost 4 liters. So you have 1 liter of blood, right? And we cannot survive with 1 liter of blood. It's very difficult. So this 4 liter that is lost, it will come from this side. From this, the lake will gradually become drier because fluid is pulling from here to here. The blood is pulling the fluid from outside. So the river, you can say when you see in the sometimes in the Marine Drive, you go to Marine Drive, okay, it's dry, sometimes it's full of water. Same thing here. So it's pulling the water. So 4 liters are coming from here. To keep our system running, because our blood vessel cannot be dried. So who will take all this responsibility? Who will take the burden on the shoulder? Interstitial fluid. So interstitial fluid is now gone to, it is slowly drying, right? Slowly drying because it is giving fluid to the blood. So now what will the after effect, when the interstitial effect will dry? Now we cannot make this whole ground of interstitial where there is lots of muscles, bones, everything is here. You cannot make it dry. So now the fluid will be, now this cells has to sacrifice the fluid. So fluid will be coming from here. So imagine this cell. So let's pick up this cell. So this cell was happy when you were drinking a lot of water. But you are not drinking water, so it has become shrink. We call it shrink, cells of shrink. It has become smaller in size. So the cell have died. So this cell have died. So why this is serious in dehydration? Because cells start dying if you don't fill it with water, because cells start dying. How the cells start dying? This is the procedure. Now let's say you are quite wise and you got some water and you drank some water. So you took Fiji water, 2 liter bottle. So there is Fiji water, 2 liter bottle in this, okay, in your stomach. So immediately when you drink water, now you are suffering here, you are lost lots of fluid. So water will be immediately, how water is absorbed? Water is absorbed from the walls of the stomach and it will go to the blood. So now it will go until it becomes 5 liter. So once it gets the 5 liter limit, then water will be transported here. Now when the river again becomes fully loaded, then water will be going here. And cells will again become happy. Again the cell will become happy. It is so by looking at the cell, I'll show it in the lab. Just by looking at the cell size of the cell in the laboratory, you can understand the person is dehydrated or over dehydrated. Suppose you are drinking 7 liters of water now. You drank 4 liters in the normal condition. Just like today, you drank 3 liters of Fiji water. What will happen? Out of this 3 liter, everything will be absorbed. So it's a normal day. You are not in any middle of the Pacific Ocean, not dehydrated. So you have drank 3 liters. So 5 liters of blood plus 3 liter, it will become 8 liter, right? So it cannot take this pressure. So first thing is that now this is a blood vessel. You can imagine normally 5 liters of blood is moving at a speed. So now you have put 3 liter extra. So what will happen to this blood vessel? So this blood vessel will be, it will try to accommodate this amount, extra amount of blood. It has swelled. It has taken its all its elastic property and make trying to accommodate. So first thing is that there can be rupture, intra-bleeding, because if the walls cannot take anymore, they will rupture. Second thing, the force, speed of the blood will increase. Normally, if the blood is going at a slow speed, at a particular speed, and you are putting some extra amount of fluid there, then suddenly 5 liters become 8 liters and it will go in a high speed. Okay, so it can cause many other problems. We'll discuss that thing later. When everything is flowing at a high speed, we call high pressure. Okay, we feel dizzy, restlessness. So that's why people complain, I have high pressure. High pressure means what? When a person says, I have maybe high pressure, blood pressure is high, means what? The fluid which is normally, just giving you a number, that if it is going at 40 km per hour, now this blood is going at 80 km per hour. but they said high pressure.
So high pressure, you'll understand when you go to restaurant, and so in some restaurant, you open the wash machine, the tap, and sometimes it all flood your clothes. It wet your clothes because the water is coming out of so high pressure. And sometimes you open the tap, water just comes slow pressure, low pressure we call, drop by drop. That is also not good. You open the tap and it ruins all your dress and everything get wet. That is also not good. It should come in a limited manner. We open it and it comes gently, that's normal pressure. That's the same way our blood should also flow. Neither in high pressure that is flowing everything and getting tearing everything and damaging everything. Or neither in low pressure that is not reaching even to the brain or the heart. That is also a difficult point. So when it's a high pressure, that's why people complain that I'm feeling very restless, very anxiety, I can't sleep. Why? Because blood is flowing at a high pressure. Blood is flowing at, instead of 40, it's going at 80. Can you sleep? You can't. Are you getting my point? If you travel in a, suppose you are going to Suva, you are going in a friend's car and he's driving at 80 km per hour, that's so normal speed, you can sleep. You can bend your seat and lie down and take a nap. But if you sit in a someone other friend and going to Suva and he's driving at 140, 160, can you sleep? You can't. You'll just hold your seat. Putting an extra seat belt, putting 5-6 seat belt, you can't sleep. Same way, we can't sleep. People complaining of, I can't sleep. I'm having anxiety. My heart is pumping very high. I can hear the sound. I can't sleep. Why? Because there is high pressure. Okay? So this is the thing. Okay, we'll discuss the good and bad about high pressure later on. So what's happening here? We are talking about dehydration. Let me not go out of the track. Okay? So we are talking about intracellular fluid, extracellular fluid. So this whole compartment is extracellular fluid. So every time you drink water, water goes here and make the blood from 5 liter to 6 liter. Now our blood volume cannot increase just like you are drinking water and you are becoming restless. How will it look? Suddenly you are normal and you take a glass of water, drink it and after that you are restless. You can't do like that, right? This will be a very different way to socialize. You can avoid drinking water. So in the same way, whenever we drink, water will go here and immediately that extra amount of water will go here. And this leg, this interstitial fluid will take the load. But if your water is going on and on and on and on, then water will go inside the cells. Now this cell, which is normally happy, these cells will be now very unhappy. The same cells will become very unhappy. It will be very unhappy. Because it has become big in size. And it will soon explode. And then it will rupture. That is also a problem. Okay? This thing mainly occurs when there is a kidney problem, because kidney is the organ in our body which removes the extra water in the form of urine. Now when there is a kidney problem, the person cannot pass in the urine, or the fluid that goes to the kidney is not going out of the body. So what will happen? Fluid is increasing. What is called edema. Edema is collection of water in the fluid. So you will see sometimes swelling. Face swelling, leg swelling. So what is leg swelling? Means in that leg part, in the interstitial fluid, this fluid is increased. So when it's called leg swelling, so in the leg, this interstitial fluid is increased. It has become, so they will call the swelling. This part is called swelling. Okay, so whenever we are not, our body naturally not able to get rid of that extra water, that water will collect where? The water will collect here. This is a natural dumping ground. So as a result, this there will be swelling, and there will be, see in the skin, there will be swelling. What is that? This is this part, what we call as medical terms, we call it edema. So edema is extra accumulation of water or fluid in the body. It can be anywhere, it depends upon the pathology, why there is edema. We'll discuss the edema later on. Today just the introduction class, okay? So we are just dealing with the terms and fluids. So if you have any question, you can ask me now. Are you clear? Are you guys clear about it? Okay,
yes,
great.
Sir.
Thank you. So, let me now recap that our body is 60% of water, right? So, 60% of water. So, some water is inside the cells. That is called intracellular fluid.
some water is present in the blood, that is intravascular fluid because it is inside the blood vessels, and rest of the water is this your lake, the river, not river, we will say lake. Okay, so where is the fluid present? In intracellular fluid, that is the two-third. Okay, this is two-third. Then fluid is present in interstitial fluid, fluid is present in intravascular fluid, that is in the blood vessels, IVF, intravascular, inside the blood vessels. Then there is a drainage pipe here, which is taking all the waste products. Fluid is present here. Okay, this is the lymphatic fluid. Then fluid is present in the lungs. Okay, we have a covering of the lungs, that is called pleura. So some amount of fluid, very small amount of fluid, not inside the lungs, remember, outside the lungs, here in the covering. So fluid is present here. Okay, called the pleural fluid. Then also fluid is present in the heart. So this is the heart, and it has got also a covering. So heart is also is floating in the fluid. Okay, so like a cradle. So this heart can, it can float. So this is, there is here fluid. So this is called pericardial fluid. Pericardial fluid, and let's say this is your knee joint. This is a joint. In our joint, this is a knee joint. In our joint, to make the joint so that our joint can bend, there is fluid here also. In our every joint. This is called synovial fluid. Okay? And where else can fluid? Fluid is present in our eyes. So let me draw one eye. Okay. So this is the eyeball. If I'm looking like this straight, so this is my eyeball. Rays of light is entering this way, and here there is the, in the back part of the, here there is a fluid. Okay. So fluid is present here, and fluid is present in the serum, of semen. So these are all fluid compartments. Okay. So whatever fluid is present inside the cells is intracellular, rest of all these are extracellular. Extracellular fluid is intravascular fluid, that is 5 liters, and interstitial fluid. These are the major components, compartment. Another small pockets of fluids are lymphatic fluid, pericardial fluid, pleural fluid, in the eyes, in the joints. That is called synovial fluid. So that is about your fluid compartments. Is that okay? Or you want?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Sir?
Yes, please.
Sir, I have a question.
Mm.
So when you meant edema?
Yeah.
Sir, like for that situation, that can occur in any part of our body, like skin,
yeah.
Any part of the body?
Yeah. It can, and sometimes people complain of swelling of face, swelling of hand, swelling of leg. Now you got hurt. Suppose someone smashed me with a baseball stick or hockey stick. What will happen? There will be edema. After 2 days, I will see there will be edema because there will be a lot of crushing. It has got damage and water will collected there. Okay, so there will be swelling. So it can happen anywhere. We got heart, it can collect. Your kidney problem, it can collect. Heart problem. Sometimes in the here also there is edema. We call heart pericardial edema. Sometimes in the lungs, in the tuberculosis, in there is another things. There is edema. So edema means collection of what fluid, where it's not supposed to be collected. Extra collection of fluid. Okay, in the interstitial tissue, remember. In the interstitial, if it is out of 5 liter, it has become 7 liter, we will not say edema of blood. Edema means fluid in the interstitial tissue. Okay, this whole ground, this is your swimming pool. So whenever water increases in the swimming, your swimming pool inside, so everybody has got a swimming pool inside. So when the water is increased, then we call it edema. Alright? So if the water decreases, it will take water from where? It will take water from here. So it's a chain reaction. If the fluid goes, blood level goes down. Suppose, for example, a person has lost, he has met at a traffic accident, he has lost 1 liter of blood because of road accident. Okay, so 4 liter becomes, so 5 liter becomes 4 liter. He has lost blood because of injury. So now our body cannot run with 4 liter blood because heart has to pump blood, and blood needs to be a proper particular amount so that it can flow to the brain and every tissue and every corner of the body. Okay, so immediately when 5 liters become 4 liter, it means the blood is carrying oxygen. So that oxygen has to reach the brain. If brain is not getting enough oxygen, what will happen? You will feel dizzy because brain needs constant amount of glucose and oxygen every second. Otherwise, you cannot work. Now, if you pay a lot of attention and studying hard, you feel very what? Your brain gets tired. Why? You're just getting low glucose. So then if you take 2-3 cookies or some sugary drink or some biscuits, then it will increase your glucose level. So whatever, if you lost some blood, so 5 liter has got 4 liter. So we cannot run our system like that. It need to be at a 5 liter. So just 1 liter will come from where? It will come from interstitial fluid. And again, it will become 5 liter and it's happy. But this part has got 1 liter down. So that 1 liter will come from here. So the cells are sacrificed. So these cells are now, which have sacrificed. Are they happy? No, they can't be happy. Now they are crying. They are crying and they are soon about to die. If you don't refill it, these cells will die. So give around. So when you become a nurse and in the hospital you see person lose blood, what you first thing you'll do? You'll connect it to IV fluid, you'll give him saline. Why are you giving saline? When you're giving a saline, means what? It is going here, it is directly going into the blood. So you're making the 5 liter as 5 liter. If you give some extra, it's not a problem because anything extra in the blood, it will go here. But when a person of emergency comes in an accident case, first thing what we do? We connect him to IV fluid. We give him a bottle of saline. Okay? We give him a bottle of fluid that is 300 ml only, or to 500 ml of fluid. Okay? And that immediately, that thing comes here. It will come here. It will come here. And when it has reached the 5 liter, then extra fluid will go here. Extra fluid will go here. When this is full, then extra fluid will go here. So more faster you give him fluid, more these cells will be able to save these cells. So when cell will die, ultimately what happens? Cell dies means what? We are dying. When a cell will die, we are dying. Slowly and slowly. So this is the basic phenomena of the water component, fluid compartment. So you have to need to know about a clear concept, okay? So I'm again telling you, don't study to pass the exam. You need to know about this. Make a clear concept. If you don't understand, let me know. So when your patient is having road traffic accident, any injury, he has lost fluid from here. He has lost fluid from this blood compartment. So fluid will be from here to here. It will move. Because there is a gap, it will move from here to here. Now, we will fill this gap. This gap will come from these cells. The cells will become smaller in size. And they are unhappy. They can't do the function. Our cells are doing all the function. Taking oxygen, giving carbon dioxide, this thing, all cells are doing. They're cooking your food and giving you glucose. So every cell inside the body, what they're doing? They're a form of kitchen. So they're cooking, whatever you're eating, they're taking it and they're cooking and giving you glucose. So this glucose goes to the blood and goes to the brain. Our brain is working along all the tissues. So these cells cannot function. So if you lose blood, cells will die, ultimately. If you don't fill it up. That's why as a nurse, when you see accident case coming, okay, so one is measuring the blood pressure, one is measuring the pulse, one is doing that thing, one is calling the supervisor, but if you're a good one, first of all, you'll connect him to IV fluid. First of all, you'll give him fluid. Then you'll do the rest of the things. Because obviously you can see that thing, we have a brain, we can analyze, okay, this person has lost blood, that's why he's unconscious, obviously. So we need to get him back. So first of all, what will you do? You'll give him IV fluid. It's called IV fluid. So what is IV fluid? It's a bottle of water fluid, which has got sodium and chloride. We call saline solution.
It is called, we call saline solution. You will give saline solution. So this saline solution, what you will do? You are putting an injection in the vein, and is putting the whole bottle of fluid inside. So this now 3 liters will become 4 liters, gradually 5 liters. You are giving more, 6 liters of blood will gradually go shift from here to here. Fluid will gradually shift from here to here. Then fluid will gradually shift from here to here. And try to get the cells back alive if you are not so late. Otherwise those cells have died, so died. Okay, many cells didn't die, but many cells you are about to save. Okay? So that is the thing about the body fluid compartment. Do you have any questions? Okay, I take it that you understood, right? Okay.
Just one last question.
No, not last question. You can ask me plenty of questions.
Yeah.
Yeah, you are paying your fees. Don't worry for that. Yes. Yeah.
Could you explain that one?
Yeah, lymphatic fluid is a big chapter. We'll take it in a different class, but I'll give you some just intro, okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay, we got a heart, you know. So this is a heart, and okay, and okay, this is a cell. Wait. And this is a cell, right? So, cell is, this is intracellular fluid, this is interstitial fluid, and this is intravascular fluid. So here, this is blood is being. Okay? So when the heart is pumping, so every time the heart pumps, it ejects out blood. So blood is moving in here. So where this blood is going? This blood is going to the distant organs. Every corner of the finger, every corner of your brain, every corner of your body should receive the blood. Why? So, because this blood is carrying oxygen. So we need oxygen for survival. So I'm just taking one blood vessel coming out of the heart. So this one blood vessel now going this close to these cells. So when it goes close to the cells, what will happen? It will give oxygen and it will take carbon dioxide. Okay, so the blood that is coming from the heart and going to the cell is giving the all the oxygen. Okay, and taking the carbon. Now what this cell do? This cell take this oxygen, and we know from our basic background the cells are mitochondria. So mitochondria use this oxygen and it prepares, it uses it in the kitchen like a flame. And then what it produce? It produces ATP, your energy. That ATP is your energy. It gives you energy by burning all glucose, whatever you eat. Okay. So the blood that is now carrying oxygen, so we call this is arteries. Now after the cell, the blood that is leaving the cell is carrying carbon dioxide, we call this venous blood. Okay, so this part is venous, this part is arterial blood. Okay. Artery means that is coming out of the heart, going to the cells. Venous means that is going towards the heart. Okay, so when you give medicine, we give it in venous blood. We don't give it in arterial blood. Okay, because veins are superficial. Whatever you see, these are in your body, whatever you see, these are veins. Because veins are superficial, it is easy to get. Arteries are deep inside. It is very difficult to get. So we give medicines, or we take blood sample, or give IV fluids, we all give in venous blood. Now this fluid is going to the right side of the heart, right? So from here, from the heart, now it is taking carbon dioxide. From here, it will go where? It will go to the lungs. So it will go to the lungs. Okay. So in the lungs, so when this blood carrying carbon dioxide. So this is right side, this is left side. So from here, right side of the heart, this carbon blood will go out of the heart, taking carbon dioxide. And we breathe out from the lungs. We breathe out through our nose. We breathe out, so carbon dioxide goes out. And we breathe oxygen, so oxygen comes in. So from the lungs, new set of blood vessels are coming, both the lungs. They're coming to the left side of the heart. So this blood that is coming here, that is creating oxygen. So we call oxygenated blood. So this is oxygenated blood, which is having oxygen. And this blood is having carbon dioxide. The blood that is going to the lungs is carbon dioxide. This is carbon dioxide, right? It is going to the lungs from the heart. It's called deoxygenated blood. Means no oxygen. Means carbon dioxide is there. So blood that is coming to the left side of the heart from the after the purification in the after the gas exchange that takes place in the lung is called, this is oxygenated blood, which again we know this cycle goes on. Now every cell here, so we have plenty cells, we have millions and millions and billions and trillions of cells. Now in the interstitial space there are some lots of waste products are being produced. So which so in every house there is a drainage pipe. We know that there is a sewage system. So there are plenty drainage pipe which are carrying the waste products. So they all join together. All join together. And dumping here. Okay, they're all joining together and dumping where? In the this venous blood. Where? In venous blood, not in arterial blood. This is oxygen, this is carbon. So they are all these small tube canals coming from the interstitial area. We call it as a lymphatic fluid. So lymphatic fluid and venous blood both are going to the right side of the heart. This is the right side. Okay, we'll discuss more depth when we'll discuss heart. Don't worry, I'll teach you everything. So this is the central. And then from the right side of the heart, it is going to the lungs. In the lungs, it gives out carbon dioxide, takes oxygen, then oxygen will come back in the this new set of blood vessels and going to the left side of the heart. So heart is then, heart then pumps this blood, this oxygen goes and gives the oxygen to the cells. So cells need oxygen for survival. We know that, that's why we need oxygen. Okay. So this blood is called oxygenated blood, deoxygenated blood, arteries, veins. Okay, and this is the lymphatic system. Is that okay?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Sir, so this is about your body fluid compartment. Okay. So today we will discuss little bit about blood, because your first chapter is blood. Okay. So normally we do lecture of blood, and in the afternoon always we do laboratory works. Like you can ask your senior students, they have done a lot of experiments in physiology relating to blood, how to take blood, how to put the syringe, needle, everything. But don't worry, these days will be over and we will soon go to the live to the lab again. Okay, so this is the blood vessels. Okay, and we know there is a, what is there in the blood vessel, we have blood. So forget about this arterial venous, but we have blood. So this is the blood. So this black is the solid portion and red is the liquid portion. So in the blood, we have this red is the plasma. And these black portions, they are cellular elements. We call the cells. Cellular elements. Cellular elements. Okay. Cellular elements. Okay, so when we take a blood, so any say this is about 10 ml of blood, we can say 10 ml of blood, there is the plasma, we call it the plasma, that is the liquid portion, plus there are some solid portions, which are called cells. So in these cells, they can be RBC, red blood cells, they can be white blood cells, they can be platelets, and they can be also electrolytes. Electrolytes. So they can be anything. Okay.
So if we take all these cells, so what will remain? It will remain in the plasma. But it will be the leftover. If we take all these cells and take it over, then all the cells, you remove it, then it will be left only the fluid portion, that is called plasma. So plasma is the liquid part. And these are the all the cells, red blood cells, white blood cells, they are just into the plasma. Right? So together we call it blood. Right? So we'll discuss about RBC. Okay, wait. So before going to RBC, you need to know electrolytes. Little bit about more about electrolytes, okay? And if you can always tell me if you don't understand. So just let me recap you this part. We know this is blood vessel and these are the cells. Right. And this is intravascular fluid. That is the blood. This is interstitial fluid. And this is intracellular fluid. All water. If you see from the overview, this is all water. Inside, outside. Apart from this, there's few other things that need to be considered. You must know about it. Okay? What are these? There are in what is present in the interstitial fluid. Apart from this, lots and lots of sodium and chloride. Lots and lots of sodium and chloride. Okay? And what are inside the cells? Inside the cells, lots and lots of potassium. Potassium. So remember one thing in your life, potassium is present more in the cells, sodium are present more outside the cells. Or sodium are extracellular, potassium is intracellular. Okay, right? So now let's say for example, you are taking a blood sample. Okay, you are taking a blood sample, you put a needle and you take some blood. Okay, you take some blood here. You take a blood sample and you send it to the lab. Now, this sodium is outside the cells. So this sodium is constantly, it is also, so sodium are more outside, so sodium is obviously, there will be more in the blood, right? Potassium are more inside the cells, so potassium, I am not saying that there is no potassium at all. There is also potassium outside, but they are in very less amount because maximum amount of potassium are inside the cell and maximum amount of sodium are outside the cells. So means we know this is blood, in the blood there are many things which are going in and out in the blood vessels. So sodiums are also going in and out. So obviously if you take a blood sample and send it to lab and you send it to lab for analysis that measure the sodium and potassium of the blood, so what you'll get more. Your sodium level will get more or potassium will get more? Which will come in the higher amount in the lab? Can someone tell me?
Sodium.
Yes, sodium. Thank you. So if you take a sample, so that's why normal sodium is 145 milli equivalent and normal potassium is 5. That doesn't mean that your potassium level is down. Your potassium is mostly inside the cell. So when you take a blood sample, you're measuring this part. So normal potassium is 5, normal sodium is 145. Remember, sodium level is always higher than potassium because potassium is hidden inside the cells. But that doesn't mean you have low potassium level. But if potassium level goes below 5, then it's a problem. It means the cells are losing potassium. So suppose your potassium level is high, say 8. It means what? Cells are losing potassium, that's why potassium is high. Okay? So when the cells die, your potassium level may go high. Okay, we'll discuss that thing. Let me not make it complicated today. But I'll stick here. Okay, so just remember this thing. So this, what is this? This sodium, potassium, chloride, these are called electrolytes. These are called electrolytes, serum electrolytes. Now, when you lose fluid in your sweat, in your blood, there is any accident, when someone lose blood, what he lose? He not only lose the water, he also lose the sodium,
he also lose the sodium chloride. Okay, that's why when you become a nurse, you know, we don't give them plain water, we give them saline water. Saline water means what? Sodium chloride. Because you are trying to refill this area. So that's why you should give saline water when you are trying to replace the deficit. Okay? In any accident cases. Now this sodium and chloride, you know, this is salt. Sodium chloride means what? This salt. And salt has the property of absorption of water. Just imagine here. Okay. I'm just trying to give you a situation here a bit. I have to buy some new markers today. Yeah. So let's say you have eaten a lot of salty food. Maybe it pickles or chicken curry, dead curry, lamb curry, whatever curry, or you like spicy food. What is that? There are lots of salt. Sodium chloride. Okay? So you have taken a heavy meal, a salty food, a salty item, or some lot of food. That has got a lot of sodium chloride, or you have taken some extra amount of salt. So where will this salt will go? This salt will go here. You have eaten, so salt is inside the stomach. Now from the stomach, we know where it goes. From the stomach, it will be absorbed and it will go to the... Where it will go? It will go to the blood vessels, right? So means what? So let's imagine now there is increased amount of sodium chloride here because of your consumption. Now sodium chloride, salt has a property of absorption of water. So if you increase the sodium chloride component in the blood because of your heavy consumption of salty food, so what will happen? You can imagine it will pull so much of water from the interstitial fluid. It will pull lot of water because of high amount of sodium chloride in the blood. Right? So 5 liters of blood will now become, say for example, it can become 7 liters of blood because of increased consumption of sodium chloride. Right? So, I told you this is your normal blood vessel and now you have 7 liters of blood. So, it will become like this. So, 5 liters becomes 7 liters. And sodium and chloride, they retain water. They will not let water go out because they have a property of holding the fluid by the process called osmosis. So your blood has become 5 liter to 7 liter. You can imagine the blood vessel has been swelled. So first thing, it can rupture, which we call internal bleeding. And then you can have just all those signs and symptoms of high blood pressure. So pressure will be high. So I told you, like if in the hose pipe, you suddenly increase a lot of, open the whole tap and the water will move high because there's a large amount of volume of water is coming out. Same thing, from 5 liter it will become 7 liter. It is very, very risky. So that's why very first thing that we advise when someone is having high pressure, which is high blood pressure, means what? Means we always tell them, first thing, you can't eat sodium or chloride, means you cannot eat any salt. If you are having high pressure, don't eat salt, because salt will increase your blood volume. Blood volume will make your heart worse. It can become, sometimes this blood vessel rupture in the brain, he can become paralyzed. And it can give you restlessness, heart is pumping very fast, heartbeat is fast, okay, you can hear heartbeat becoming very loud, so many things can happen. That's why first thing, before giving medicines in any high blood pressure patient, don't take salt. Now what will happen if someone is having dehydration? Okay, let's take a reverse situation. Instead of 5 liter, he's in dehydration, he lost blood or he goes to a state of dehydration and 5 liter become 4 liter. So will you give him just water to drink? No. We'll give him water mixed with salt. So that salty water will go here and it will retain more water. Okay? Because he has lost sodium chloride also. Okay? So that's why if you have someone having low pressure, we immediately give him fluid. What fluid do you give? We give saline water. Now when you go to hospital, you'll get many bottles of fluid. Some contains sodium chloride, some contains sugar, dextrose, that is called glucose. Okay? So, you have got choice. Now, you are the only nurse in the duty and you got an accident case, came, and you got 2 bottles of fluid. one is of sodium chloride, one is of sugar, glucose. Which one you will give?
Sodium chloride.
Very good. That's excellent. That's common sense. Someone is coming just now. So early. Anyway. Okay? And if you have not attended the class, then what will you do? You will give glucose. The patient don't need glucose now. We can give energy later on. First, let him come back. So that is the choice you can, you have to make yourself. And if somebody gives a glucose, bottle of glucose to a dying patient, then also you should also tell him that look, you are making a mistake. Let's start with sodium chloride. Let's start with saline solution, not glucose. Now his whole thing is pressure is normalized, everything is normalized, his blood has gone to normal level. Now you can give him some energy and you can give him some glucose. But why you should give? Yes.
So,
yeah.
So what if our patient is already having high blood pressure and we're not sure like what amount to give, what amount of salt to put in inside his body?
We'll discuss that thing in the blood pressure. Look, normal blood pressure is 120/80. Okay, when the blood pressure goes beyond say more than 140, we say high blood pressure. Okay, when the pressure goes down, we say like 70/40, you get low blood pressure. We'll discuss in the blood pressure, don't worry. But like, if, like I understood your question, you said if a person has a high blood pressure, suppose a person has a high blood pressure, let's for example 180/100, he has a high blood pressure and he has a, unfortunately he met with an accident and he lost blood, then this blood pressure will not be 180 if he lost blood, it will go down. So that's why we also measure the blood pressure at the same time. So this pressure is going down means he is losing water. This pressure is going up means he has enough water. Don't give any more. Okay? That's the importance of taking the blood pressure. So we learned that in the lab. But this thing is related to salt, sodium chloride. Sodium chloride is here. Okay? So that's why if somebody lose water, his pressure will go down and then we'll give sodium chloride. Okay? So in the any emergency room, in your hospital, there are plenty fluids bottles. Okay? There are plenty fluid bottles. Some has sodium chloride, some has other electrolytes, okay, like magnesium, phosphate, bicarbonates, some has glucose. So you have to decide which one to give according to the situation. A person with an accident who is unconscious, he has lost 2-3 liters of blood. If you give him glucose, then please don't. Okay? Now if a person has lots of blood and you are giving him glucose, then you are actually helping him to go up. So we try to first balance the fluid, then we'll try to balance the other things. Okay? This fluid is very important because we have to help. We have to stop the cells from dying. Because you are losing fluid, fluid is going from interstitial to blood. And then fluid from cells are going to interstitial, so cells are dying. What are these cells? These cells are present all over the body. We are made up of cells. Each and every cell is joining together to make a human body. So more and more cells are dying, we are dying. So that's the concept of body fluids.